Now I would like to beg Dr. Kashin from Russia. Dr. Kashin is the director of endoscopy in Yaroslavl, one of the main centers of interventional endoscopy in Russia, and he has also a very interesting case for us.
Stefan, thank you very much for your kind introduction. Dear Professor Ziewelt, dear colleagues, it's a great pleasure and honor for me to be invited at the EndoSwiss course and to present our case. So, can I have the next slide? Oh, yes, it works. So, three sessile polyps, 20 millimeters in size, were detected in a 65 years old woman in antrum and gastric body. The initial approach to gastric polyps included both polyp histology and the surrounding mucosa, because further management should be based on histology results. Here you can see the results of forceps biopsy, and may I ask you to comment the results of forceps biopsy?
Basically, what you can see here is, on the upper part, you see a pronounced foveolar hyperplasia, and you see some tumor infiltrating from below. You have a hypervascular and inflammatory stroma. In this part, you see an adenoma. I mean, you see the stratified nuclei that are enlarged. You see here normal mucosa. You see here a tubular adenoma. And again, here you see a plus of tissue here. And in addition, it's a background of atrophic gastritis. For real hyperplasia, you see inflammation, and you will see some intestinal metaplasia.
So thank you very much. It is very important for us. So in two polyps, we have benign histology, no any tumor cells, just hyperplasia or foveolar hyperplasia. And in one lesion in the middle, we have low-grade adenoma. So I have several questions for the audience and for the expert. For the experts, should we perform polypectomy for two benign lesions or just treat the neoplastic lesion and follow up the patient? And the second question, should we use magnifying narrowband imaging endoscopy for the assessment of microstructure of all the polyps? Philippe, may I ask you about your opinion? Should we resect all the polyps? Two of them with no tumor cells.
Yeah. So I think from my practice, these are the polyps that I will believe it's quite sizable to me. So generally, I would resect all these polyps. So I think the other question is whether you should send all the polyps to pathology. So that's another question. So if you ask me whether I should resect these polyps, and if I look at the size, I would definitely resect it. But if you characterize and look at the pattern, then you may find, you may be able to differentiate those who are appeared more like a hyperplastic appearance, and whether you should actually send this polyp in, you know, to confirm the pathology, it all depends. So if your accuracy of making this diagnosis is good, and then you may reduce the cost of endoscopy by not sending these to the pathologies if they are pretty much like benign.
And what kind of treatment modalities do you use? Just simple polypectomy or EMR or ESD? Or we need to use high magnification with narrowband imaging in order to make the correct decision?
Well, frankly speaking, I always use, because as pointed out previously, I think through the discussion, if we look at the characterization, then we may be able to see the demarcation line better for the middle part of that polyp, because for the upper and also the lower, I can see a very distinct margin with probably a stalk over there. So I'm not too worried, but it's still a good practice for you to look at the resection margin. But for the lesion in the middle, I can see it's more like a elevated lesion, and I have to look at the extent of this lesion before I can decide.
Thank you very much. Araf, may I ask you a question? What is your opinion and what is the European point of view? Should we use narrowband imaging or other imaging modalities for characterization of each lesions? What are the European guidelines? And also for the background mucosa? Or white light endoscopy is enough for make a decision?
I think we have the MAPS guidelines in Europe, and there it is suggested that NBI can facilitate the detection of precursor lesions, mainly intestinal metaplasia, so it is advised to use it, or classical chromoendoscopy. As for the detection, I think we're on the similar level as the Japanese, that there is insufficient proof to use it as a detection tool. Although I don't think it can be harmful as long as you still do the white light inspection. And for the lesions, I certainly think we need it, especially in the stomach, to look for how big they are before you embark on a resection. I was just discussing with Professor Ino here, now that I have the mic, that what about HP eradication as a therapy in this patient?
Yes.
First?
H. pylori was eradicated. It is very important because in most of our hospitals we have no any chance to use narrowband imaging or other imaging modalities in everyday practice. And what should we do to refer the patient to the expert center with polyps? So let me continue. I completely agree with Rav Bishops and all of the experts. Let's start from the assessment of background mucosa. Conventional white light endoscopy is limited to detecting plastic lesions on the basis of gross morphological changes due to the low reliability and validity. And NBI, as other imaging modalities, of course, demonstrates high both are superior to white light endoscopy in diagnosis of gastrointestinal metaplasia and, of course, dysplastic lesions. It is very important in case of adenoma with dysplasia because when we inspect the background mucosa, we can find other synchronous lesions, dysplastic lesions. Here you can see the results of the assessment of background mucosa. Can I ask you to comment the results?
Basically, you have the classical appearance of a chronic atrophic gastritis. All the eccentric mucosa is basically gone and replaced by glands which have some pyloric metaplasia. You see the chronic infiltrate, lymphohistiocytic, and you see intestinal metaplasia. And here pointed out by the arrow are the small cells which indicate ECL hyperplasia.
So the results are typical for maybe not only adenoma, but also for neuroendocrine tumor. And then we use high magnification narrowband imaging endoscopy in order to assess the microstructure of all the lesions. Here you can see the first one in the middle part of the body. And we have three areas with different type patterns, microvascular patterns and surface patterns. Can I ask you, now Hisa, can I ask you to comment all of these patterns? Because the upper image looks like benign and gastritis, regular vascular pattern, regular mucosal pattern, but the lower image have any irregularities.
At least the middle image within this three images, it looks a little bit irregular. So I believe that this is neoplastic area. And also that this surface structure relatively dilated, but probably influenced by some inflammation. But at least this area, this is very suspicious for having neoplastic lesion.
Thank you very much. We decided that the tumor may grow extensively beneath the epithelium, as you can see at the lower image. And here you can see the histological results of after resection of this polypoid lesion.
So basically what you have is a tumor growing from the submucosa. You see here these small rounded cells growing in little balls, staining positive chromogranin. So it's a classical example of a G1 net with low proliferation rate of under 2%.
So here you can see the results of interpretation, histological interpretation of all of these pictures. So let me show you the next slide, the next lesion, gastric superficially elevated 2A lesion, also 10 millimeters in size in lower third of gastric body. We also have several different areas with the regular vascular pattern and irregular mucosal pattern in the center part of the lesion. And I have the question for the experts. What about demarcation line in this case? It is very difficult to assess it. We have discussed it with Stefan, and he told me that he clearly seen the demarcation line, but what about Japanese experts? Now he's
I think that demarcation line is located here. Only this, because of the structure becomes much smaller than the surrounding mucosa, so I think mm-hmm. that only this slightly, a flat area with slightly small surface structure is the area of neoplastic area. All the surrounding area is a kind of reactive granulation.
Do you have any comments?
Yeah. So yeah, I agree. So we can see the demarcation, but I think the compared to the surrounding architecture, there's only slight irregularity in the central part as compared to the surrounding. So maybe this is not a very advanced severe type of cancer neoplastic process, but in a transient process from background, maybe some IM or something, and then change it to just like a dysplasia in the center.
And so Philip, what is your opinion? Is it low-grade adenoma or high-grade?
I think if you look at this pattern, so there's still some preservation, although it's very irregular, but there's still some preservation of the architecture. Maybe it's just a very low-grade process, maybe. Mm-hmm. But I cannot 100% sure. But frankly speaking, we can see a demarcation line. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Let me show you the results of endoscopic mucosal resection of this lesion.
So basically, this is the picture we saw before on the left, and this is just a picture of a tubular intestinal adenoma low grade. Here you see the crowding of the glands normal appearing mucosa, and you see this clear distinction between the normal glands and the crowded dysplastic glands.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And the third lesion, 20 millimeter sessile polyp in the antrum, type 01S. Normal mucosa pattern and normal histology. But after the resection, we were very surprised.
Well, basically what you find here is actually that you have a plus of tissue in the plus in the submucosa. And what you see is these very slender spindle cells here, which are arranged somehow in a concentric fashion around vessels. Also intermingled, you have lymphocytes and some eosinophilic granulocytes, and this is the typical picture of an inflammatory polyp.
Thank you very much. Let me conclude. All types of gastric polyps need to be sampled, and also not only polyps, but background mucosa. The type of gastric net should be determined in each case by a biopsy of the lesion and surrounding normal mucosa, and in case of inflammatory fibroid polyp, forceps biopsy and also neuroendocrine tumor, forceps biopsy may be negative because of the submucosal growth. Can we rely on histology obtained by forceps biopsy? No. Two studies and the latest meta-analysis of 16 studies published a year ago showed that one out of four forceps biopsy might be underdiagnosed. And the management, all gastric adenomatous polyps and dysplastic polyps should be completely removed with tumor negative margins. Neuroendocrine tumors should be staged appropriately, and treatment options should be discussed with the multidisciplinary team. And inflammatory fibroid polyps, a very rare type of gastric polyps, do not have a malignant potential, but are associated with chronic atrophic gastritis, and also should be resected for the correct histological interpretation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sergey. So that was all in one, and a very good teaching case.